That's what we're here to explore, the opportunities in golf. Our next speaker is also going to take us on a little bit of a federal overview with it. Marianne Dickinson has more than 35 years experience working with water issues, so she's very well versed in this topic. She's the president and CEO of the Alliance for Water Efficiency, which is a nonprofit organization that's dedicated to promoting efficient and sustainable use of water. They're headquartered in Chicago, but the Alliance works with more than 365 water utilities, water conservation professionals in business and industry, planners, regulators, and consumers. So she has a broad audience who she speaks with. So Marianne.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and thanks especially to Jim for inviting me to speak. This is a real pleasure to be here. And as Veronica said, you know, we talked a little bit about, you know, how we would differentiate the federal perspective from the national perspective. It sounded like it would be the same thing, right? But what I thought I would talk to you about instead was the perspective nationally that we have of what is affecting water utilities and water utility customers around the country, because most of you, many of you, get your water supply for your golf facilities from a municipal water system of some kind. Some of you are on your own groundwater wells, but many, I think, right, are on municipal water supplies. So what happens in your community affects not only what you can do, but the perception of what you can do by your neighbors. So that's kind of what I wanted to deal with in this presentation. So to move on to it, let's talk a little bit about those consumers, because the consumer perceptions, I think, drive politically a lot of what is going on out there. And here are a couple of sample consumer perceptions. We have plenty of water. Isn't that what my water utility always says? Yeah, the water utility is always saying, we provide you reliable service. Another perception, my tap water is not clean enough to drink. Isn't that why I'm always buying bottled water? So they don't even think that the water that they get from their water utility meets water quality standards suitable for their tap. And then one of the most prevailing consumer perceptions, it's outrageous that my water bill is always going up. For what? If there's plenty of water and I don't even drink it anyway because I don't think it's safe to drink, why should I be paying continually higher amounts for it? And then, my favorite one here for this audience, don't ask me to conserve when that golf course down the street uses so much water. Because that's, unfortunately, their perception. They have no idea how much water they are applying on their own landscape, and instead, they're looking at you. So this is the political reality that you have to deal with. And a lot of it has to do with myths that we are, at the Alliance for Water Efficiency, struggling to educate consumers on, educate even water utilities on. So I'm going to run through quickly a couple of these myths. Myth number one, what water shortages? Here's a utility ad for a book that the American Water Works Association published. The coming water crisis is like a giant asteroid hurtling toward Earth. But is it really? Most consumers do not perceive that. They perceive that there's plenty of water out there, and every time it rains, as Veronica said, then they just sort of get complacent that they don't need to continue to conserve. And if you look at the drought monitor, you've seen already an example of what it looks like now, but this is what it looked like in 2010. The country was largely not in drought. Even California, which always is in drought, was largely not in drought. So, you know, a lot of wet weather, a lot of complacent customers. And when we're not in drought, the water utilities around the country actually are not happy, because many of them want to sell the water that comes from drought, because then you have to irrigate, and that often is very high tail block revenue that's important to that water utility. So if they don't sell enough water in a wet year, they have revenue losses, that means then they have to raise their rates. Not a very popular activity with the customers, because the customers, ironically, expect the bill to go down when it rains. They don't perceive that they're actually getting a service for their water bill. They perceive that they're buying less unit blocks of water, so their bill should be lower and the rate should be lower. So conservation behavior flip-flops. It often diminishes when it rains and when there isn't a perceived drought. And then the costs that the utility has often get forgotten in this drive, because they want to sell, if they have water to sell, they want to sell it. In a wet year, they have more water than when they have in a dry year. And then it results in this seesaw phenomenon. And then when you have a real drought, here again it's October 30th of 2012, you know, you've got the country looking very different than it did in 2010, but the consumer behavior is still the same. So what we have to begin to adopt in this country is better ways to deal with what this continuing pattern is going to be going into the future, because it may actually be getting a whole lot worse. Veronica talked about the study that was done now 10 years ago. We need to redo this study. It's at least 40 of the 50 states. I suspect it's probably close to 45. We have states that are really going to be dealing with shortages and the expense of those shortages going forward. Myth number two, well, it doesn't matter. Government will pay for it. Government will fund our water infrastructure. Haven't they always? Haven't we always gotten federal money to build drinking water and wastewater treatment facilities? Well, yes, that was true in the past, but it's not true anymore. And going forward, the estimates, they're ranging, but at least one EPA estimate was that there would be over $500 billion of a shortfall between year 2000 and 2010, and that was the gap between how much money was needed for infrastructure facilities and how much was actually available. This is the gap. So, you know, we've got some federal funding programs. We have the stimulus program. And the grim reality is the stimulus bill, as big as it was, $787 billion, didn't really spend anything on water. Crying need on water infrastructure, but only $6 billion was spent for water infrastructure in that bill, and didn't do much to address this funding gap that we're talking about here. And now we know going forward, you know, with all of the rhetoric and the elections in this past sort of 4 years of serious economic climate, we know that there is no money in the federal government for large-scale subsidy of water systems the way there might have been in the past, both on the quality side and on the quantity side. And now ratepayers are facing the fact that they have to pay for this on their own. Private water companies have always had to deal with this, but the public water systems are now facing this for the first time. So if you're getting water from a public water system, this is going to be a debate in your community. Here's another myth. Well, we're growing, but the new growth is efficient, so we don't need to worry about it. And that theoretically is true. We have federal laws that specify much more efficient fixtures in the past than we had in the past, but we didn't find that this was actually translating into actual lower water use. And as we're building more and more homes, even in this depressed economy, we know that by 2030, we're going to need to build a lot more housing. There was a Brookings study that was done that said half of the homes that are going to exist in 2030 haven't been built yet. So we know we have an opportunity to build more efficiently. And older studies that were done up till 2004 or so were showing that the new homes were actually using more than the older ones, largely because of outdoor irrigation and inefficient irrigation systems. And so as we're growing, even in these dry areas, we need to make sure that those houses are being built and businesses are being established to be as efficient as possible. But primarily, we're not growing where there is water, and that's one of the troubling aspects of this. You know, if you look at this map, which shows water availability, the bluer states, of course, have the most water. The yellow states don't. But where are we growing? You know, this is a chart that shows the difference in population between the year 2000 and 2020 and what the difference in population is going to be in those states. So look at California, 52% more population. Texas, 35%. Nevada, 24%. But in contrast that with Michigan at 4%, we are not growing where we have water. And that's a phenomenon that is part of our political landscape, but it means there will be growing scarcity in those states where population is growing, but the water is staying fixed. So if you have a golf course in those states, you need to perceive that over time this is going to be a continuing battle. Now, we've made a lot of great forward progress. Veronica talked about the WaterSense program, which is a huge benefit to water efficiency. There's a new home spec in the WaterSense program. The U.S. Green Building Council has a program called LEED that's made great strides forward. There are voluntary codes and standards that have been developed both nationally and at the local level. And the new home studies that are now being done, especially new residential end-use data, they're showing that we're beginning to make progress, and the new homes are beginning to use less. But it's taking some time, and it's taking a lot of dedicated effort. And one of the issues that we need to address is the outdoor landscape irrigation phenomenon. Because unlike you in your golf course management, you know you need to manage to a finite water budget. The customer has absolutely no idea on the residential side how much water they're actually using, or even the business owner has no idea how much they're applying to the landscape. And that's part of our continuing education need. And that leads me into my fourth myth. It's an automatic irrigation system. It doesn't need to be managed because it's automatic. And that's probably the biggest consumer myth we have out there. And I offer my father as Exhibit A, who has a black box in his garage on the wall. He says, that's the controller. He says, I don't touch it, I just leave it alone. And it irrigates every single morning for half an hour. And I can't get him to turn the clock back because it's a magic box, you don't touch it. This is what we've got going on in the United States. And the last residential end user study that we did showed that as much as 58% of that sample size that was all across the country went to outdoor irrigation. And I'll be very interested in the new update of that study to see what it is now. We know that in arid areas of the country that number is quite high. In Phoenix and some areas of the West, it can be as high as 75 or 80%. That's where the water is going in these water utility systems. It's not going necessarily on your golf course. It's going into all these individual unmanaged properties. And so this is the big issue that we want to focus on at the Alliance for Water Efficiency. Because the facts of it are that the aggregated consumption for all these little properties are way more than what individual golf courses are doing. That's not to say you shouldn't be sustainably managing your properties, as you clearly are on a path to do, but it means politically the perception in your community is going to be this, that the customer doesn't realize what a big role they have on the residential side in contributing to this. It's a significant user of water in commercial properties. It's typically unmanaged on the commercial side. That's where we see lots of opportunities for savings. And smart irrigation is becoming the new norm. There's lots of terrific technology out there. I don't have to tell you, you know it, you're using it. But the average homeowner is not using it, nor is often the average business owner. So we need to get these tools out there. We need to get the smart controllers out there. We need to get rain sensors and moisture sensors out there. And we'll be talking a lot about that over the course of the next day and a half, and I look forward to hearing your experiences on this. Here's another myth. We've got a water problem, we've got an energy problem, and they're not connected. But they are connected. You can't generate electricity without using water. So in the United States Geological Survey report that's done every 5 years, U.S. daily water usage, 49% of it, 49% of all water use is going toward power plant cooling. Now, it isn't completely consumptive. A lot of that water is returned in the environment, but it's returned in an altered state, and you still have to have that much water in a stream in order to be able to withdraw it. So it does relate to how much water there is in the system. Energy needs a lot of water, whether it's traditional power plant, thermoelectric power plant cooling, or whether it's biofuels or any other new alternate source development, it all needs water. And then we need electricity to pump, treat, and move water, and to heat hot water at the consumer end. This is a chart from a study in California that documented how much energy was needed in kilowatt hours per million gallons at every stage of that process. And it depended upon where you were locally and how much you pumped and how level you were and what elevation you had and what kind of treatment process you had. But it could range anywhere between 2,000 and 20,000 kilowatt hours for every million gallons of water that you run through your system. And in my hometown of Lake Arrowhead, our number is actually 24,000 kilowatt hours when we take state water project water. Huge energy load for that water. So water and energy are actually very much connected. And in California, which is the only state to have done some comprehensive numbers, 19% of the electric energy load in California is due to the pumping, treatment, and movement of water. 32% of the natural gas load is related to the heating of that water. And so these are big numbers that we're looking to try and evaluate across the country to see what they're like. The national studies that have been done so far show anywhere between 12 and 13% of the national electric energy load being related to water. And so if you think about how much that is, you realize that as you save water, you're saving energy, and as you're saving energy, you're saving greenhouse gas emissions. And so now as we're talking about climate change, we need to realize that saving water and water conservation can actually provide some climate change benefits. And here's a graph from a report done by River Network in 2009 that estimates what the carbon footprint is of water. And that 5% of U.S. carbon likely is related to water. And you can see the residential hot water heating, 58%, that big blue part of the pie chart, that's actually a fairly large amount of carbon. So we need to be thinking about integrated solutions, and water efficiency has multiple benefits. So water and energy are definitely connected. Here's myth number six. This is my favorite one. Water conservation, it doesn't really work. And besides, even if it does work, it costs too much, so we shouldn't be doing it. And it's astounding to me in this day and age that we still have this perception, because we have had 30 years of terrific experience documenting that water conservation does work. Here's a chart from the Seattle Public Utilities showing their drop in consumption, you know, from the period of 1980 to 2010, showing how the total consumption has gone down. That's the solid black line. And then their bill consumption is the lighter gray line. So what that means is you have to make sure your bill consumption is also keeping level with your revenues. And it's really showing that they met their goal of reducing 1% per year their consumption over a 30-year period. They did it. It does work. And they did it through a series of measures, both passive and active conservation. Passive meaning you pass laws and it happens on its own. Active meaning that you actually fund programs for consumers to do water efficiency improvements on their properties. And we see these kinds of programs working all across the country. Here's a little chart we put together. A number of cities in the United States that have reductions in per capita water use from their conservation programs. We know this works. And we know that when you compare efficient and inefficient homes, that it's a very successful strategy to retrofit those houses to the water sense standards, or even just to the legal requirements that were passed in 1992 in the Energy Policy Act. Even retrofitting to that level is a huge benefit for many of these older communities. And it can be as much as, you know, 23 gallons a day difference consumed just by retrofitting the plumbing fixtures and doing nothing else. So we know this works. And we know it's actually improving. The WaterSense program has labeled, you know, hundreds of plumbing products that are beyond the federal standard, 20% more efficient than the federal standard. So they're terrific opportunities for this kind of retrofit. But the consumers still don't perceive that, and often many water utility managers don't perceive it either. And so as we document these gains and this positive progress, it's part of what we do at the Alliance for Water Efficiency, we want to be continuing to promote looking at water use and making it as efficient as possible. Because what it does is it saves the utility money. And this is the long-term message for them. In this particular chart, you see that solid line being, you know, a stylized estimate of demand going up over the course of a number of decades. But if they reduce the demand with conservation to that dotted line that you see in that chart, the existing capacity can stretch another 10 years or more. And by existing capacity, we mean a reservoir or a treatment plant, anything that has a fixed capacity that needs to be augmented because you're running out of space or time. And so with now no new reservoirs really being able to be built in this country, and treatment plants becoming extraordinarily expensive, conservation becomes a terrific, good investment for water utilities that need to save money for their consumers and keep their rates as affordable as possible. Because the consumer is always going to complain that the rates are not low enough. They'll pay three times more for their cell phone bill than they'll pay for the water bill, and it's still an outrageous expense for their family. And they basically have been convinced that they can conserve at this point, because if they conserve, the water bill is just going to go up, so what's the point? And this is the big issue that we're fighting now at the Alliance for Water Efficiency, because there are a lot of reasons why water bills need to go up. It has nothing to do with conservation, although it is a big factor. True, when you use less water, you're making less revenue for the water utility. But there are many factors that are going into why water rates in this country need to go up. And they have mostly to do with the aging infrastructure that has to be replaced, the additional capacity that has to be built, and new supplies that have to be gotten. And then, you know, taking in all the factors that are here in this rate drivers list, these are all the reasons why consumption is going down in this country. Yes, we have, you know, codes and standards that are requiring new fixtures and they're using less demand. We have active conservation programs that's reducing demand. But the recession has been a huge reduction for many water utilities across the country. You know, businesses and industries that are going from three shifts to two, foreclosed homes that are empty and not using water, these are real impacts to the revenue stream of a water utility. And when that revenue stream goes down, they have to raise the rate to recover the rest of that revenue. The wet weather, I showed you the chart from 2010 of the drought monitor. When it's wet like that, they don't sell irrigation water, and then suddenly they're revenue short. And so, of course, the cost to replace aging pipes and pumps and treatment plant facilities, and then, of course, you've got inflation. All of that contributes to the now unfortunate perception that the water and wastewater industry is rising faster than the consumer price index. So if you take a look at this particular chart, the light blue line is water and sewer. And we're right up there with cable and garbage as the fastest, highest rising cost for the consumer. Not very popular place to be when electricity, for example, the orange line, is so much lower. We're finding out we've deferred so much maintenance on our facilities that it's now all coming home to roost, and it's one of the reasons why this chart looks the way it does. Here's a little disaggregated view of it from 1978 to 2010, and you can see water and sewer is just way up there. So this is something that's happening. It's going to affect the price of your water if you're buying water from a municipal system. It's going to reward your efficiency efforts because your return on investment is going to be terrific. But this is happening everywhere out there, and it's one of the reasons why we need to provide better information for the consumer. Because everything is relative. You know, water is still a bargain in this country. A 30% rise in rates is often no more than $5 a month increase in the average customer bill. But they don't perceive that because they focus on the 30%, as does the media. And many water rates are even as cheap as a tenth of a cent a gallon in many of our communities. But a customer will pay thousands of times more for bottled water than they will from water from their tap. So it's a perception problem that we need to deal with. So what about the future? What are recommendations we can make for the future? We need to continue our drive to get more efficiency in codes and standards, and we need to continue to develop new products and to install new products that are going to always be the most efficient way we can use water. Conservation programs should be funded by the water system and the water utility where it can incentivize consumer behavior and change. Many water utilities in the West work with golf courses in a very active way to help them reduce their water use, and there may be incentives, particularly to connect to recycled water from those water utilities. And we believe that efficiency and conservation should be the first thing that's considered in kind of a loading order of actions toward water use and consumption, to consider that as your first fallback activity. And again, in the golf course industry, you've been looking at that already, but that isn't true in all other business sectors. Demand's lowering across the United States on a per capita basis, but it's still going to be increasing as population grows. So what we need to make sure is as we're adapting to that population growth and the change that climate is likely to bring, we need to make our water utilities sustainable and stable in the way they're collecting revenue. Because if it's a seesaw and how rates are going up and down, it also affects your ability to project on a business case basis what water is going to cost you for your facility. So finally, what it comes down to is the consumer needs to be educated. If the consumer, the average residential consumer, which is, you know, the high percentage of the ratepayer electorate there that votes in these rate increases, if the consumers don't understand the reasons why water is going up or why water rates need to change, then we're not going to get to where we need to in this country. So we at the Alliance for Water Efficiency are attempting to address all of these issues. We're hoping to be of help not only to you but to other sectors of business and water utility communities. We've only been around for 5 years now, but we are looking to be the national voice for how water efficiency should happen in this country. Here's a map that shows where our membership is. We have members all across the country, maybe not in the Dakotas, but you know, pretty much everywhere else. And we have a great website that I hope you'll visit. Just type in allianceforwaterefficiency.org, and there's a wealth of information on our website. We have a resource library with a long list of topic areas that you can search and go through. Here's a screenshot of the resource library. And we originally built in 2008. It gets extraordinary use. We had, most recently, we did an analysis of our statistics, and we have had 606,000 people visit us in the past year with over 8 million website hits and over 550,000 documents downloaded. So we obviously have built a resource that people are coming to look at and use, and so we're very happy about that. And we also maintain something called the Legislative Watch. So if you're interested in what's going to happen in federal policy in this next Congress, if there's going to be federal policy on water in this next Congress, you can find it here and track it here, because we report on every bill that is proposed in the House and the Senate that deals with water efficiency or its tie-in with energy efficiency. And we've also built a consumer website called Home Water Works, and its URL is home-water-works.org. And it is a guide to the consumer for how they can be more efficient. It's got a very sexy water calculator that zooms and flies around like a video game. It's very slick, and it gives very simple, straightforward answers about what their consumer's water use might be, and then it sends them on a little detective mission throughout the house to drill down and get the actual information that'll narrow it down and make their estimate more specific. It's backed by an ET, a zip code database, so by zip code, the customer can find out what the ET values are in their area so they can make sure their landscape is irrigated properly. So that's one of the things that we've developed. We've developed documents like the water pricing primer, advice to water utilities on how to construct their water rates. We've done an analysis on water efficiency and jobs, how many jobs can be created by funding water efficiency programs. We had hoped to get $10 billion in the stimulus bill. It didn't work, but the analysis still stands. You could get as many as 220,000 new jobs by funding $10 billion worth of water efficiency activity in this country. We've done work on water and energy. Some of the slides that I've showed you were from that project, and we have a blueprint for action, recommendations for national policy. I invite you to go look at that. And then we've just recently done an analysis of state policies in all the 50 states and graded the states as to how good they are. No state earned an A, but we have two A minuses, California and Texas, and lots of Bs. And overall, across the United States, the US itself earned a C grade, so we have lots of improvements that we can make in terms of progressive policies. And so you can check our website and look at the detailed profiles for your state and see how it fared. And here's a chart showing the scores of the states. And we also built a tool, an analysis tool, water conservation tracking tool, that helps water utilities analyze the conservation benefits and gives them cool charts that shows how much savings they've got from various programs and customer classes across the years, helps show them how their service area demands can be lowered through the conservation programs, gives them a benefit cost analysis with a return on investment where you see red, that means that activities may be not cost effective. But most importantly, it helps them because it gives them an analysis of how their revenue changes with the implementation of conservation programs. So the blue bars show in the early years where the rate has to go up, but then it goes down across, after about 5 or 6 years, it goes down and is a benefit to the customer. If you debt finance, that's what the red bars are, you kind of reverse that. But at least the water utilities will have the ability to analyze for the first time how a water conservation activity or reduction in demand will affect their revenue stream. So these are important planning tools. We also built an energy component to it that estimates greenhouse gas emissions. So a conservation program now can be quantified as to how much electricity it saves and how much emissions it also reduces, greenhouse gas emissions. So these are the kinds of tools we're trying to put in the hands of water utilities to help them address their ongoing need to plan sustainable water supplies for the future. But I've got to return and finish with the customer, because we still have a problem with the average customer. We have had no national education program on water in the United States to speak of. It's always left to the local water utility. And so we wanted to try at the Alliance to try and launch some sort of message that we hope would go viral in all the social media tools that would basically get consumers to realize that they shouldn't be wasting water, because there's a cost to that waste, and there's not only an economic but a social and environmental cost to that waste. So this program that we're designing is set to launch in March of 2013, and anyone who's a member can get it for free. If you're available next week on the 14th of November, I'm giving a webinar that'll explain how the program will work, and you're all welcome to attend. What we're trying to do is harness the power of 60 million consumers that we already have in our membership to get those consumers to suddenly invoke this campaign. And as I say, the campaign itself is free to our members. It's basically built on a social marketing platform, but it'll have print ads and billboards and bill inserts and bus cards and all the things that you expect to see in a consumer campaign. And it's based on the concept of never waste. And we have a water bottle here that's a symbol of that measure of waste. So here's an example of one of the ads. The water running toilet waste can fill 800 of these bottles in one day. So we're trying to get the consumer to realize that running toilet is a lot of water. And this is a quantified amount of water that everybody's used to seeing. So if it's 800 of these in one day, that's actually a fairly significant amount of water. And so this campaign called neverwaste.org is the one that we're going to be launching in March. And the bottle is filled with all kinds of fun facts. I brought one as a sample. We can take a look at it in the next couple of days. But I'd love it if any of you were interested in being part of this, because I think the more we can get the consumers to realize that they have a piece, they have a stake in this long-term sustainability future of ours, and they need to understand their role and how that works. Because if we don't get them all together with us, you know, we're not all going to move forward together. And the alliance is named the alliance for a reason. We're trying to pull together stakeholders from all walks of life to come and provide a water efficiency message that will stick. And that's one of the reasons why I'm delighted that Jim invited me to come and speak to you, because I think you're a very important part of that stakeholder community. So I think I'll finish with that. I hope I've made it on time, and look forward to talking with you all during the question.